大家好，我是魏德胜，和大家推荐热兰遮之泪。荷兰的温斯缪出生在1634年的莱顿，依靠着虔诚的信仰，他随着东印度公司前往到福尔摩沙台湾来传扬上帝的福音，然后也凭借着祖先所留下来的笔记和字条上的生动的描述，记载着1651年到1661年他和福尔摩沙之间的故事。他的后代子孙完成了这部日记体的小说。有这么一个年轻人，如何准备执行神交办给他的一些任务，陷入了爱河，在漫长的航行到亚洲的这个海上旅程，他和他的家人如何在地球的另一端建立起自己的家，摸着石头过河，不断的在错误中学习，同时他也见证了大航海时代下荷兰共和国所主导下的教会政治跟军事的发展。这一切的发生都在福尔摩沙，来得急又快，然后冲击了他的家人以及他自己。时代的洪流之下，他和他的家人和台湾的历史、荷兰的历史连结在一起。这本《热兰遮之泪》是荷兰的故事，也是台湾人的故事，推荐给大家。
Pieter Wensemius, born 1942 in Voorburg in the Netherlands near The Hague. I'm a physicist by training, and after being in physics for a long time, writing a PhD, I went into business in McKinsey & Company, and from that I joined the Dutch cabinet as environment minister. This is in 82-86, and at the moment I'm doing nothing, except writing books every once in a while. My father actually was the chief advisor for Prime Minister Lee Kuan Yew in Singapore way back. So we have a very strong connection with Singapore and therefore with the Southeast Asia. And my father also was the first researcher in the family history from Arnoldus Wensemius, who is a great grand uncle of ours, who was a minister in Taiwan, Formosa, in the 1600s, in 1654, 1660. And he started studying that when he was there, and I basically got this type of interest from him, so I inherited it and finished his story more or less. My father actually inherited the interest in family history from my grandfather. My grandfather was at 4 years of grade school, so very little, but he was a beautiful researcher and a great writer. And so he started researching the family history. And we had this one ancestor, Arnoldus. Actually, he's not an ancestor, he's a great uncle of ours, who was born in 1634 and died in Taiwan in 1660, I should say. And Arnoldus became something of a mystery to us. How does somebody from the Netherlands wind up in Taiwan in the 1700s? So my father started researching him. There was a lot of written about him and his colleagues who were other ministers in Taiwan. And I basically inherited the story. It was not complete, so I inherited the story. I decided to write it up with the notes that my father wrote and my own additions. So that was the start of this whole story. And it got out of control. It turned into a big book. Actually, the thickest one I ever wrote, I believe. But it's a big book. And it was a lovely story to write because you got very, very close to people way, way back with all these things, and you started knowing. I went to bed with him in the evening and I woke up in the morning for years with Arnoldus and his family. And it's amazing, amazing experience. Basically, the information comes from very many sources. This book is faction, as they call it. Faction is facts that I put together with fantasy, if you want. So a part of his history, a part of it is guessing what happened in between. So it's lots of little facts. You learn somebody's born in 1634, and his father, you learn, died 1.5 years later because of the plague, and then his mother remarried. Now you get all these little facts, and after a while you get a fairly complete story. But there's always gaps in between. For instance, when he married, he got his inheritance. He was 17 years old, he got his inheritance, and that was the Dutch kept very specific records, very solid records of the inheritance. And the inheritance therefore says in great detail how much money he owned, what type of property, houses, etc. he had, but also what type of debts he paid. Now you could see he paid for a silver ring. And he could know the silver ring, you know the date, and that was his marriage. And then 6 weeks later, they were married, and then they started collecting, he started buying books. And then he eventually bought very strong alcoholic drinks for his travel to the Far East. Apparently they didn't trust the water or something, so they bought very strong. And you get all these details, how much they bought and what it, and all the little facts. All these little facts together add up to a story. Now, in Taiwan, the Dutch kept a very strong record. So I know what type of weather it was every day of the 6 years that he spent in Taiwan. Because the Dutch have a record there that says it was stormy weather on the 3rd of November. And then they have, all kinds of details they provide for what happened there. And it's all recorded. And so you have to put all these things together. And after a while, you get a complete story. So it's very fascinating because everyone says, yeah, this is how it happened. This is how it must have happened. That's terrific. Dates in the book are all facts, basically. There must be some that I imagined, but almost every date in the book is a fact. And you have all these records. The Dutch were fantastic with their administration, especially when they're out in Fort Zeelandia, that's the Dutch fortress in Taiwan. They have very, very great detail. So those are facts. But the most amazing fact was when I was nearly finished with the book, I had a complete text, and I decided to Google. Just as a final effort, Google is a fantastic source for information, of course. So I Googled Dutch ministers, Formosa, that's the Dutch word for Taiwan, 17th century. And on page 6 of Google, you never get to page 6 on Google, but on page 6 I found this information. I have to see whether I can find it. But this, it was unbelievable that you get that type of information. I must be able to find it. Where's the Dutch book? Here. Okay. Can't find it. It's amazing. We probably have to redo that when I find the proper page, I must say. Thomas. You got your 5 seconds here, Lily. Okay. Now, so you get all this information. And then I was Googling, and on page 6 of Google, I found this page here. These pages. And they were from a Dutch Bible, a 17th century Bible. And the story was in 1948, shortly after the Second World War, somebody at the Dutch embassy, a very junior person at the Dutch embassy in Beijing, was looking into researching the administration, the files, the archives of the Catholic Church in northern Beijing, Catholic Cathedral in northern Beijing, can you imagine? And he found a Dutch Bible and he took pictures. And these pictures, in 1980, he was retired and he decided to write up the story of these pictures. He still had the pictures. The Bible is lost, apparently. And then this is the pages from the Bible with the notes that the person who owned the Bible wrote. And this was my ancestor. And you see here, this was his first son was born, his second daughter was born, the third son was born, and his wife died. And this was in 1660, what was it? Sinkan, December 1660. He himself had died in 1661. And so this 8 months later, he himself died. And this was a complete shock for me because I lived with them for such a long time and she died. And I knew that she survived him. I knew his widow survived him. So he must have remarried after that. And that type of thing, that type of information you had to put together. But this, when I found she died, they were so close and they experienced so many things together. That's where you learn that type of thing. That's Yeah, very emotional to deal with, even now. So it was beautiful. But to find these notes that told about his children, we didn't know about this child, we didn't know about this child, we knew about this child. This child came back in the Netherlands when he was 5 years old, without parents. And he came back to the Netherlands. This child we didn't know. This child was born 6 weeks before they left to Taiwan in December. They left in December, 16 December or something like that. And 6 weeks beforehand, this child was born. And so they went on a boat Can you imagine 17th century? You say to your daughter, you say, hey, that's lovely with central heating, etc. on the ships. And it's lovely, go ahead. The child survived. And they went to Batavia, Jakarta, survived. Stayed for 2 or 3 months in Jakarta, went on to Taiwan, survived. And 6 weeks later, the child dies. But the first thing the father does in Taiwan as a minister is probably bury his own child. And that's very emotional, that type of thing. And those are stories that, you know, with fantasy, you can't even invent that type of story. You can't, because this is real life, and brings it all back. So it was fantastic to do that. Beautiful experience. Beautiful experience. You get very close to these people. Arnoldus, his father, was Isaacus. Isaacus died when he was 1.5 years old. I wrote another book that's not published, on Isaacus. And Isaacus was a miracle person almost, how he in that period grew up and in Leiden. The town of Leiden was a very booming town in the 17th century. The Dutch were very powerful economically at that stage. And Isaacus made a fantastic life, and then suddenly he died with the plague there. And his wife survived with the small child, only one child. The other children died as well. 1/3 of the population died during the plague in 1633. And his wife, Maria, lived on and remarried. Now, and she was hugely important to Arnoldus. And you can feel that throughout the text, you can't escape it. The person she remarried, Isaacus, second Isaacus actually, her first husband also was called so, the second Isaacus was also very important, because when she passed away, he took the role for the father of Arnoldus. And they were very close, extremely close. You can sense it throughout the story. He did everything to get this young person ready for his long, faraway travel, and very dangerous travel to Formosa. The Dutch went to Formosa at that stage. Most of them didn't last 5 years because of the tropical diseases, etc. It was very dangerous territory to live in. And then he married with Maria. Second Maria, mother also was called so Maria, but his wife was also called Marietje. And he married her, and she must have been a very powerful person. She was very young, and she wanted to get married. She came from the wrong side of town, as they call it. You can see that because you know where she grew up, and that was a part which was not very rich, and she was obviously from the wrong side of town. But when they married, they got a child. She was expecting a child already when they got married, which was quite amazing at that stage, because he was a minister. It was not supposed to happen. But on the other hand, she probably wanted to join him on the travel. And then the VOC, the Dutch East Indies Company, paid their way so she could come along. So she probably, they said, this is the only way that you can join me. So they went, the two of them went there. They spent only 6 years. He was maybe 25, he was 27 or something when he died. And in those 27 years, 25 years, they experienced more than the normal, if you have a crowd of 100 people in 4 lives. They experienced more things in a very, very strange type of environment. He was 17 when he graduated from university. He was 11 when he went to the university. When he was 17, he also had learned one of the Formosan languages. They have, I believe, 24 languages in Formosa at that stage. And he learned one of the 24 languages, so he could be a minister outside the fortress, outside the Dutch community, in a Taiwanese community. Can you imagine the jump if you come from a country like that? In that time, no communications, a letter from the Netherlands took 8 months to get to Taiwan. 8 months. Now you sit there in your machine and you Google something and you get 8 months for a letter and to get a return. Ah, that's an unbelievable world. So you get very fond of them. This is amazing, but you get it regularly at the time that in the 17th century, in the stories, the women are very important and they have a very strong role and much different from what you expect, because it's always the man and then follow the woman. Very often it's not true. Very often the women are the stable power in the whole situation. She obviously was. So the loss, that's why this finding this note that she died, it was for me, was very upsetting, very upsetting. Another marvelous person in this, which by the way is the other minister, Dominee Hambroek. Hambroek was is in Dutch history, is much better known than my ancestor. There's paintings, he went to Koxinga, the famous Chinese general. and he went to Koxinga to negotiate for the Dutch, and it was a very dangerous thing. So again, lots of stories written about him, but there were four ministers, and Koxinga, Hambroek and my ancestor Arnoldus must have been extremely close. That's quite obvious. They were witnesses at each other's marriage, etc., those type of things. So they must have been extremely close. And I went to the church where Hambroek was minister before he went to Taiwan. It's in Schipluiden. It's between Rotterdam and The Hague, a very small town, where they still have a sign for him there. I actually paid some money for putting up that sign with other folks, because Hambroek was an important man at that stage, in that community, in that small environment. I find it very difficult to say, because it's a long time ago, but I studied family history, and lots of family, our family, later on in the 19th century, went to, for instance, the United States, at a very early stage. And they left their homes, and a lot of them has been written up on that, how they left, and they knew they wouldn't come back. And that's very emotional, and so it's described very, very, very detailed how that all the things happened many times. The strange part, on the other hand, is that Arnoldus learned from Mosen, from a former minister who was in Taiwan before he came back. He was one of the great ministers in Taiwan, the first minister, Candidus, and he came back to the Netherlands and he started teaching young ministers the language so they to prepare him for the mission in Taiwan. And there was in Amsterdam, so he went there and he learned from him about Taiwan, the language, also how you had to deal with religion in Taiwan. It was a very, if you want, superficial type of religion you would look at it now. They converted Taiwanese, but it was a very light level of making the changes. Taiwan at that stage had still and there's lots of pictures drawn by the Dutch. I mean, you look at those things and it's amazing. They had all these older religions there. And the Dutch came with this new religion, and they had to translate texts, Bible texts and songs and psalms, etc., for the specific purpose, into Dutch, from Dutch into the Formosan language. And Candidus set that up first, and the following ministers built on his base there. So they made many people join the Dutch church, but how deep was their religion? That's a good question. How deep was the religion for the ministers? That's actually your question. Now, not without reason, I mentioned the roots of Arnoldus, his mother, his father. He never knew his father really, 1.5 years old, when his father passed away. His stepfather, they were the roots that he had in the Netherlands. And these roots are very deep. And you can recognize that they were very much a part of a solid Dutch community where religion played a huge role. Otherwise, he wouldn't have studying theology, and he wouldn't have made that move. That's quite obvious. So he must have known the high risk, but on the other hand, he knew that people came back also from the east, far east. Most of the time they didn't come back, but they did come back. So he must have had hope that he would return at some stage. 6 years that he lived there was quite long, actually. Two children died and his wife eventually died, probably because of diseases that were unknown in this part of the world here. It's difficult to say, but he must have had an extremely strong belief to survive that and to keep doing that. At the end, the last year was of his life, when Marietje's wife died, it was a period of great suspense in Formosa. Koxinga was on the mainland. Koxinga was actually almost expelled from the mainland. He was thrown out of China, mainland China. And he it was a very uncertain existence for Koxinga and his Chinese people. In an increasingly small part of the country. So they decided to make a step to Taiwan, because it was safe there, they could defend it. They were very powerful on sea, Koxinga and his people. So they wanted to move there, but the Dutch were there. So they said to the Dutch, hey, move over, we're going to sit there, and we don't mind when you sit here, but you have to move because we must find a new place. And the Dutch were at that stage very powerful, and they couldn't believe that some heathens, some Chinese, you know, would throw them out of their property in Taiwan. And so they couldn't just move over because Koxinghagen said so. If they would have, they probably would have survived together because they were trading a lot with Koxinghagen's people already at that stage. So they had, it was very beneficial to both sides to keep a peace. They didn't, the Dutch probably couldn't handle that. So they, Koxinghagen started threatening them. And when Marietje died, December 1660, it was already a situation that you, well, this is not going to turn out right. In March, Koxinghagen attacked. And the Dutch thought that it would, you know, would throw him out because earlier they had some uprisings and they just shot some guns over the heads of the Formosans and they ran because they were an unorganized army. But Koxinghagen was a very organized, very experienced army. And they had never experienced that, the Dutch, never. And so Koxinghagen didn't run with his people. And they basically kept a siege on the fortress of Zeelandia. And they didn't do much. They didn't kill many people. Both sides didn't do much. They just sat there and until the Dutch would give up, basically. And that didn't turn out right. There was, the Dutch sent a fleet to free the fortress. And the captain of the fleet was not the smartest person in the world. If he was the dumbest, I don't know, but he was close to the dumbest. And he started shooting guns at Koxinghagen's army. And Koxinghagen said, this is breach of our semi-peace. So we can't have that. And it can't have that. So we must send an example. And the example was probably why my ancestor was killed. And with 400 Dutch, all Dutch outside the fortress were killed, all of them, in one day. Amazing. And then, this was in September, and in February the fortress surrendered, and Koxinghagen let everybody go with their weapons, with their money, with everything. So Koxinghagen probably wasn't against the Dutch. He had to set an example because the Dutch shot guns at his army. Well, they had a semi-peace there, you know. They was basically getting the Dutch to stop sitting there and say, hey, this is not very useful. That's my guess. But I wasn't there. Well, it's probably a dream come true that this book appears in Taiwan and then hopefully also in Singapore, largely because of my father. It probably is one of my father's dreams. My father was deeply into these stories, deeply. He actually did visit Taiwan to look at these sites, and he went to Sing Kam, that hardly exists anymore, where our ancestor was a minister. And you can find the place probably where the old church was because there was at a river and there was a bridge there. But you can't recognize anything. It's a big town there. But for him, it was a dream. And when he started going to the Singapore, Lee Kuan Yew obviously was one of his great friends. And they talked about these things. My father always talked about China and the development, that where the new powers in the world would be in that part of the world. And so for him, it would be a dream. And, you know, when you grow up and your father has a dream, you are affected by the dreams of your parents. So I took that dream, and when I got the chance to write this up in great detail, it was one of the fun experiences, but it would be, for me, from this side of the world, I visited Taiwan a couple of times, but for a short period only. I don't know Taiwan. I don't know it. But hopefully the people of Taiwan can recognize something of their own history. Taiwan history is much shorter even than ours. Obviously, it's very old, but it's still shorter. There's not much written up on that period. And so this is a perspective of a Dutch minister and his wife in a very foreign world, very far away. It's not the perspective of the Taiwan people, but hopefully they can recognize something in there of their, so that it creates some part, fills some part of the Taiwan history, and that would be, you know, a dream.
各位台湾的读者大家好，我是王丽静，丽丽王。今天很开心有这个机会在台北国际书展跟大家推荐一本荷兰的小说《Nie zonder tranen》。这本书的中文版将会由前卫出版社发行， 而我担任这本书的译者。很高兴荷兰驻台代表处对这本书的青睐，将我们带到了台北国际书展，也让我有机会跟大家推荐和介绍一下这本书。尼松德特阿呢，说的是一名荷兰年轻的传教士，在荷兰立定志向，决心到遥远的东方福尔摩沙。他为了这件事情做了很多的准备，他先在荷兰阿姆斯特丹学习了新港文，目的就是为了跟福尔摩沙上面的居民传递神的福音。他的家庭生活，他的爱情生活，如何和他的新婚妻子一起来到了遥远的东方，面对的是完全截然不同的文化、风俗、语言、地理、气候，他面对到很多的挑战。不仅如此，400年前的台湾是一个大航海的时代，这个岛上有汉人、荷兰人、西拉雅、原住民，还有的是更多不知名的热带疾病等待着他。那个时候的台湾有政治、有军事，各种层层叠叠的角力和危险。身为一个渺小的传教士，他如何和他的妻子和家人在台湾生活，甚至在这边留下他的足迹，这就是这本书在描写的故事。尼松德特阿呢，这本书跟我有着非常奇妙的缘分。我是先看了他这本小说，这本小说是在2016年的时候出版的。我看完了以后非常的感慨，因为在台湾念书的时候呢，对于荷兰人在台湾的这短短38年里面，其实台湾在教科书上只有短短的一个段落，就说郑成功来了，荷兰人走了。但这38年来，荷兰人在台湾做了什么？他们的故事其实并不是很多人都知道的，可能在文史工作者上有比较多的研究跟学术的讨论，但身为一个一般的市井小民，我对于荷兰人到底400年前在台湾做了什么事情，这些故事我们都不知道。到了荷兰以后，我也发现荷兰人对于400年前他们到过台湾这件事情不是所有人都知道的。所以这38年来在台湾的历史对很多人来说就是一个消失的一块拼图，然后等待着很多人把这里的故事找回来。那尼松德特阿呢，就是这片拼图里面的一个部分。我看完这本书以后呢，就想尽办法找人介绍，去找到这本书的作者 Peter。 他本身写的其实就是他家族的故事，然后我第一次见到他的时候，我是怎么跟他说的？我跟他说，你并不认识我，但是我看了你的书，认为这本书需要被台湾的读者阅读，请你给我一个机会，也请你让我把这个书带到台湾来。那 Peter 很有趣，他就说他其实没有想过有一天会有个台湾女生敲他的门说把他们家的故事带到台湾去，所以我就这样成了他这本书的文稿代理人。因为这是一个非常纠结的故事，当然在福尔摩沙的生活有喜悦，有挣扎，有挫折。那他们在异地是怎么样 每天每天的度过的。当然他是牧师，所以他的信仰给他很多的帮助，但是这个主人翁的乐观还有他太太的勇气，让他们的生活非常的多彩多姿，以外也很勇敢的面对所有的挑战。那我身为一个在荷兰打拼的台湾人，在阅读的时候其实也获得了很大的支持。我真的很希望说台湾的读者也能够感受到他们的勇气跟努力不懈的乐观态度。400年的台湾，那个时候对于400年前的荷兰是多么遥远的距离啊！一封信你要送到家人的手上要历经8个月，这个还是如果这个船没有遭遇到任何的意外的话，这封信才能够平安的送到你家人的手上，那也是8个月以后的事情了。是什么样的信念跟什么样的勇气，让这个家境堪称优渥的牧师决定前往东方的土地？然后他在福尔摩沙遇到了很多的困难，有政治上的挤压跟角力，他跟他的太太在福尔摩沙经历了丧子之痛，他自己在台湾丢掉了一只右眼。这所有的经历，他跟台湾的命运是紧紧绑在一起的。我其实非常的感佩说他跟他的太太在台湾做了这么多的事情，在遇到这么多的挑战都能够用很乐观跟勇敢的心态来面对。那个时候的大航海时代，对一对传教士的夫妇来说，他们的身份可是远比一艘海上的树叶还微不足道的。但是这样的时代的巨流就把他们一家人卷入了时代的漩涡里面去，然后他们也在里面找到了他们自己的方向。我常常在想，如果我是这个传教士，我会跟他做出一样的决定吗？如果我是传教士的太太，我能够像他一样这样勇敢乐观吗？他们在400年前所遇到的问题是400年前的问题，但是在字里行间中你可以感受到，其实他们遇到的挑战我们在现在也有类似的挑战。有他们这样子乐观跟积极的态度，其实给了读者还有译者就是我很大的鼓励。这是我在翻译跟阅读这本书所得到最大的收获。我在翻译《逆松的他》呢这本书的时候呢，我其实对这本书更深层的背景并不是这么的了解。然后我在跟书的作者 Peter 聊过了以后，才知道说这本书事实上就是他们家族的故事。书中的主角这位传教士事实上是 Peter 的好几代以前的阿伯。那这是流传在他们家族里的故事，而且这本书的整理跟所有的誊写是3代人的努力，也就是Peter 的阿公交给了他开始这个工作，交给了他的爸爸。他爸爸呢在过世之前是有整理了一些很完整的资料交给 Peter， 交代他说你一定要把这本书写下来，把 我们家的故事流传下去。因为他们家的故事不仅仅是只有他们家的故事，他们家的故事还有包括台湾的故事跟荷兰的故事。所以当我在跟Peter 聊天的时候呢，我们都对于这件事情的意想不到的巧合发展呢，觉得一切都是非常的奇妙的。那这本书里面还有一个部分我觉得非常的有趣，就是女性角色在这本书里面也占了相当大的比重。我们以前会说只有登山公没有登山妈，就是在航海的过程渡过黑水沟对女性来说是非常艰苦的。所以我当初的印象是认为福尔摩沙400年前女性的话大部分就是原住民的女性，汉人的女性应该是非常的少数，跟遑论荷兰人的女性。但在这本书里面你可以看到说牧师的太太，还有就是一些长官的荷兰长官的太太，他们是跟着先生来到福尔摩沙的。那女性的角色在他们的日常生活中扮演了很大的一个功能。这些女生不仅仅是随着丈夫来到了福尔摩沙，他们在社区里面也起了一定的影响力跟作用。这是我以前完全没有想到的。我以为只有荷兰的男性会随着东印度公司来到福尔摩沙跟巴达维亚，但没有想到其实是有不少的女性也随着家人来到了亚洲，来到了东方，甚至在整个福尔摩沙的生活中他们也起了一定的作用。这跟我原本的想象是完全不一样的。然后我相信这件事情可能大家也从来没有想过，但它就是明确的记载着他们在台湾的痕迹。这是我翻译这本书跟阅读这本书的时候我觉得最有趣的一件事情。霓虹的 China 是一本历史小说，也就是说它里面所有的人名、地名、艺名都必须要非常的精准跟正确。我在翻译这本小说的时候，所有这些专有名词都是参考乐兰遮城日志。我很开心跟大家分享这本书《霓虹的 China》。这本书的中文版即将在台湾出版。我希望你们跟我一样都非常喜欢这本书，也能够感受一下400年前台湾跟荷兰的友谊早就已经深深的绑在一起。有前卫出版社的好眼光，让他们带着这本书到台湾来，也感谢荷兰驻台的代表处给我们这个机会跟大家分享这本书。如果大家有什么其他的问题的话，我很乐意替大家回答，也期待你们跟我一样这么的喜欢这本书。拜拜。